Good evening, everyone. We welcome you all to Ortho TV Online Original Webinar Series. Today we have a senior arthroplasty surgeon, Dr. Mohit Arora. He is the director of orthopedics and joint replacement surgeon from Fortis Escort Hospital, Amritsar. We also have on the panel Dr. Salim Patel, senior medical advisor from Zydus, and Dr. Gaurav Kanade, assistant professor in D.Y. Patil Hospital and Medical College, Navi Mumbai. This webinar is brought to us by Zydus Cadila, the makers of Leucoxia. So over to Dr. Mohit Arora.
Good evening, everyone. The topic for today is, in our setup, especially in Asian countries where people love to sit on the ground, so the demand of high flexion knee is very high. It's raising day by day. And now, because most of the patients, they need to sit on the ground, like Muslims, they want to sit for namaz. The Sikhs and Hindus, they go to their temples, etc. The flexion of the knee is less than the patient's knee. But we just wanted to search out with the design of the knee, is it decides the post-operative knee flexion. So my answer is, not just the design of the, you have to understand what is the need of a high flexion demands, when it's the needed. Now the first thing is climbing stairs. Depending on the size of the stairs, 75 degrees to approximately 140 degrees of bending is needed for that. Rising up from the chair 90 to 120 degrees. Getting into bath, sitting on a low seat, we need 135 degrees of bending at the knee. And gardening, golfing, then we need 130 to 150 degrees of flexion of the knee. Now, the advantages of a high flexion. So although the degree of post-operative knee flexion does not affect the patient's satisfaction, does not affect the walking of the patient, the painless life, but it definitely influences the fulfillment of expectations, functional ability, and knee perception, a normal knee perception, that it bends like a normal knee. Now, just a high flexion implant cannot predict the post-operative high flexion. So post-operatively, how the patient behaves and how much flexion of the knee is, it is a multifactorial thing. Now, the different factors which depend upon it are the preoperative factors, which include the preoperative range of motion, the ligament laxity, preoperatively the deformities like the FFDs, the varus deformities or valgus deformities, and preoperative range of motion. Second is the intraoperative factors that we are the most important as a surgeon's perspective, like what you do during surgery really depends and really considers how the patient is going to behave postoperatively. Postoperative factors that includes the physiotherapy part and pain control and the design of the joint, fourth factor. So we'll be discussing one by one. First of all, the intraoperative factors, which are in your hand. Now, there are two types of factors when you're going for a surgery. One is a thing which is a constant factor, but definitely there are variable factors. Variable factors is what the surgeon does to the patient. So the first factor is the posterior translation of the implant. Now, if the deformity is very high, we see at times that the PCL is very tight, and a tight PCL, then there is not a translation and the flexion gap goes less. If the flexion gap is less, it's not a balanced knee, then chances are there that the flexion postoperatively will be low, even if you are going for a high flex design. So you need to have a functional PCL when you're doing a surgery. If your PCL is very tight, the deformity, varus and valgus are very high, then immediately shift on to a PS system and not a CR system, because posterior substituting system, posterior cruciate ligament substitute system is better, and it gives at least a predictable flexion to the knee. Next is, whenever there is a tight PCL that I discussed, so a tight posterior cruciate ligament results in tightness in the flexion and early loosening, as well as a decreased flexion of the patient. Because if you promise a patient preoperatively, yes, you will be getting a good high flexion, I'm giving you a high flexion system, you'll be getting a good flexion, and you go for a CR system, it's a tight PCL, definitely the patient is going to be disappointed in spite of doing the best for the patient. So adequate PCL balancing is very important. Either release the PCL slightly from the femoral component. If you can balance the knee in that, it's perfectly okay. If you can't, then shift on to a PS system. Now, the type of total knee, there's a PCR and PS system. There's a cruciate retaining system and the PS system. The passively movements, they're totally and weight bearing the range of motion. They are really equal, but provided you do a balanced surgery. So a consistent posterior translation is very, very important preoperatively for getting a good range of motion. And you should be having a good flexion gap for a better movement, better range. Next is a posterior condyle offset. These days there have been many studies regarding the posterior condyle offset. So this is what we say, like in the figure we have seen, there is an X. So it is the posterior condyle offset is the distance between the posterior margin of the femur and the condyle. So the higher the posterior condyle offset, the better will be the range of motion. So for every 2 millimeter decrease in the condyle offset, the maximum flexion was reduced by a mean of 12.2 degrees. This has been seen in a study by Mr. Bellman in JBJS. Now, next is a larger flexion gap. If the slope is higher rather than, so PCL substituting processes can provide you more predictable flexion gap and larger flexion angle, as I told you. But if you are getting a PCL retaining joint, then better is there that you give a better, more slope to the patient, like 5 degree slope to the tibia, so that the flexion gap is larger if the PCL is tight. So that way you can manage, but never leave a flexion gap low. Otherwise, the range of motion is going to be less. Now coming on to the sagittal laxity. What is sagittal laxity? Basically, when we bend the knee in 75 degrees and we try to translate the tibia on femur, that has to be seen. If this laxity is less than 5 millimeter, that means the flexion gap is less and the range of motion will be less, and the patient will not get a good flexion. It was concluded that anterior-posterior laxity in excess of 5 millimeter in prosthetic knee is desirable. And for an unimpaired joint function, although the upper limit of expectation, acceptable and AP laxity could not be identified. So a moderate laxity, which is 5 to 10 millimeter that is expected, is likely associated with it. So significant better outcome and minimum hyperextension. Don Dejor et al. Compared the PCR and posterior stabilized knees for 4 years postoperatively using the clinical examination and radiological laxity on weight-bearing radiographs. So more than 10 millimeter of anterior translation had a worst outcome and bad knee score, which was observed. So the knees with more than 10 millimeter of anterior posterior laxity at 75 degrees had significantly less flexion, low knee scores, and knees with 5 to 10 millimeter of AP laxity and PCL retaining knees were better. So the laxity in 75 degrees, and the translation of the tibia on femur should be moderate, neither too high nor very less. 5 to 10 millimeter is sufficient. Less than 5 is a trouble. More than 10, you're going to get an unstable knee which is further trouble to the patient. A painful knee, the range of motion will not be great, and the patient will never be a happy patient. So next is a trapezoidal flexion gap, which is again a problem. The range of flexion was decreased as the incidence of medial tibial plane and zone 1 radiolucencies in trapezoidal flexion space was seen. So having a balanced knee and a properly rotated femoral component is very important when you go for a flexion knee. So if a femoral component rotation was more internal, and you cut medially, laterally, you cut less, and medially, you cut more, then definitely it's a symptomatic patient, which 5.5 degrees is there, then the patients are going to be symptomatic. And whereas laxity in flexion was higher in symptomatic patients, 11 degrees than in controls. So a lateral laxity in flexion increases the postoperative flexion angles and cruciate retaining and total knee replacements. So medial joint light opening should be, if it is in flexion, 2.6 to plus minus 1 degrees. At 30 degrees, this much, at 5 millimeter, and in 90 degrees, 7 millimeter. So lateral joint line opening should 3, 5.9 and 8. So rotational laxity should 14, 34 and at 30 degrees should be 33.4 centimeter or 36 plus minus. So the next point is the joint line maintenance. Joint line maintenance is if you can see if the joint line from the medial meniscal scar or from the lower pole of patella, you have to be approximately 10 millimeter lower than the lower pole of patella. That is the exact point where you go for a joint line. So if the joint line is maintained, the chances of getting a good flexion during surgery are very high. If joint line is not maintained, either it is elevated and then you get a patella baja, or if the joint line is decreased, then you get a patella alta, then it's going to be a patella femoral articulation is going to be a trouble, and the patient will not be a happy patient. The flexion will be decreased. So if joint line is less than or equal to 1, got a flexion more than 120 degrees, and most were having less flexion patients. Now, a posterior osteophyte removal. This is a very important factor, because when the joint translates, posteriorly osteophytes, if they are there in femur, they have to be removed with a curved osteotome, and the posterior capsule has also to be resected to get a better translating tibia on the femur and getting a high flexion of the knee. Efficacy of tibial slope, as I told, that in a tibial slope, as the tibial slope decreases, the flexion decreases, and as the tibial slope increases, the flexion gap increases, but it should be that high that you get an unstable knee and create a trouble and may dislocate in flexion. So it has to be a generous slope. 3 to 5 degree slope is very good if for getting a balanced and a good flexion knee. So increasing tibial slope, a high load on the anterior portion of polyclean, if you increase it more, then the problem is that high load on the anterior portion of the polyclean and the knee unstable in flexion as a total. So the effect of a tibial slope on range of motion and range of motion after post-PCL sacrificing knee, but increasing posterior slope does not result into significant range of motion for a special surgery functional score. So avoid increasing the patella thickness. Next factor, if you resurface the patella and the patella, left patella is thicker, then for every, can I please pause it? Sorry. So for every more than 20% of increase in the thickness of patella, 26% were flexed more than 100 degrees. But if patella was lesser by 20%, then 97 degree patients had flexion more than 100 degrees. So good flexion less than 0.8 mm and poor flexion if it is more than 2.5 mm. So that we have to see for the thickness of patella. So slightly flexed position of a femoral component, posteriorly tilted positioning of the tibia can create a slightly better range of motions and wound closure. Now coming on to the wound closure. So the wound closure, if we do in flexion, that is 90 degrees to 110 degrees of flexion, at six months, there are 2 degree more flexion as compared to the preoperative range, which was 4 degree less flexion with extension closure. So the, because they say that in flexion, if we close the soft tissue, they're a bit lax, so you get a better range of motion. So no difference in early postoperative, but 2 to 3 months follow-up are there, but later on, you get a better range of motion if you do a wound closure in flexion. So tunique, use of tunique. If you don't use a tunique, the muscle dystrophy is less, so knee flexion is better initially in 1 week, but in later on, it doesn't affect much. Minimal invasive knee doesn't make any difference. They would not find any better results in MIS. Yes, later on in higher flexion, because ranges up to 120 degrees, it was okay initially. But later on, if we do a minimal invasive surgery, you do less of muscle cutting, less of muscle dystrophy is there, you get a better range of motion. Post-operative factors, aggressive rehabilitation and adequate pain control is very important in a post-operative times to get a better range of motion, because if a painful knee, the physiotherapy cannot be good, so you can't get a good range of motion. And the last factor, which is the design. Now, design of the joint, which they say high flexion design. So these high flexion knees that they are coming in the market, they come with a thicker posterior femoral condyle, and they go with extra 2 millimeter of bone cutting on the posterior aspect. So this gives a deep anterior patella cut is also there. So these two things, a deep anterior patella cut and a thicker posterior condyle of the femur, they can give us a better range of motion. And single axis knees, then they came with a relaxed posterior slope of the tibial polyethylene, a reduced femoral size, improved the collateral ligaments function in a deep flexion. So with coming with the narrow joints, the narrow implants, like for the females, they are coming with a narrow joint in the femur. So they are also very helpful in giving a high flexion. Then design of a high flexion, a smaller femoral radius, as was shown in the last time. Sorry. This is a single radial axis knee was designed just for a better range of motion. And then the small femoral radius, if it's there, then there is a large flexion gap, which causes a better range of motion postoperatively. And internal rotation of tibia at times, because in high flexion, the tibia internally rotates. So if we go for a mobile bearing knee, the chances of getting a better rotation of the better flexion of the knee are very high. So the mobile bearing joints like RPF were designed for this high rotating platform, high flexion knees were designed just for getting a better range of motion post-operatively. So it's more, the range of motion between the high flexion knee and the standard knee. The high flexion designs and those which are standard designs were found to have a similar range of motion for under both non-weight bearing things and weight bearing conditions. Moreover, no significant difference was found when the in some studies, like it was done at Jong Kyun Sian, and in March 2009, the study was done which showed no difference between both the joints implants. But to summarize all the factors, the range of motion post-operatively in a knee replacement is multifactorial. So high flexion design gives a better range of motion provided a proper patient selection is there, a proper implant selection is there, proper technique is used during surgery, and a proper physiotherapy is there post-operatively. Thank you.
So, Dr. Taroda, that was a very good comprehensive coverage of high flex TKR. So, Dr. Salim Patel, do you have any queries for him?
Yeah, a good lecture, sir. Very interesting talk indeed. So, my question is, what are your experiences with the RPF and with the Zimmer Next Gen in the high flex knee? Which one do you prefer?
I prefer an RPF.
RPF. Your reasons,
of, there are a few reasons in it. Number one, it's a mobile bearing system and rotating platform is there. So the rotating platform really gives us a better things that because there is internal rotation of the TBI when you go above 120 degrees and you get a better range. Second, in RPF, there is 2 mm extra cut in posterior femoral condyle, which gives again a better flexion gap and a better range of motion. In this and the anterior cut in the TBL, but in the next gen, though what I've seen in my experience, if a person is having good muscular structure, is slim and has got good preoperative range of motion, is mentally strong, he can get highest range of motion even with a simple PFC.
Okay. So, or even
an all poly system. So the high flexion is basically what we are doing is just for the demand of the patient that I need a high flexion. But really the simple joints also do wonders. Once it is done properly, number one, and secondly, if your patient selection is proper.
So, secondly, question, sir, is like post-operatively, you keep all your patients on CPM?
No, I not even a single patient.
You don't do that.
We do manual physiotherapy.
Okay.
We just teach them no CPM. We don't use a CPM because in some patients, it may cause myositis, number one. It may cause muscle tear also. And because if the patient is not able to, there's going to be a stiff knee or the range of motion, the CPM you put on to one thing. So I want the patient to do active exercises from the day 3.
Right.
Day 1, we start just standing and isometrics. Day 2, we start with slight bending, approximately 30 to 60 degrees. From day 3 onwards, we start active physiotherapy and active exercises of the patient. The pain walking is started on the day 1 only, but I don't use any pain cocktails or any steroids during surgery, so that I don't use that because these are all old patients, immunocompromised, some are diabetics. So I just give epidural anesthesia and at times just IV.
Energy
as
a patient.
Right. Thank you.
Yeah.
Gauro, you have any queries for
her,
sir?
Yes, sir. I just wanted to ask whether during counseling to the patient, do you assure them the flexion of the knee will be more than the normal knee?
One thing is sure that if the patients, what the latest studies say that the range of motion, it increases by 20% if it is less. If a person is having preoperative motion up to 10 degrees to 80 degrees of flexion, then definitely a high flexion knee is not going to give them a full flexion, or she cannot sit cross-legged or squat. That we say no to them initially only by preoperative examination. We just tell them that your range of motion is going to increase approximately 20% from that. Yeah, if it is approximately 110 degrees of flexion pre-op, then it's okay with the high flexion system. The patient will get a good things. because if you do a proper sloping and proper flexion, a balanced knee is there and a high flexion system, it goes very good.
In case of any, is there any difference in the cruciate retaining and PCL substituting?
Yeah, definitely. There's too much of difference. If it's a deformity, like if the patient's deformity is very high, that means varus deformity more than 20 degrees, there is FFD for 15 to 20 degrees, and too much of varus deformity is there. In such patients, what we see is that the PCL is very tight. So if you try to do a CR system in these patients, then the extension gap is okay, but the flexion gaps go low. So if you put that way, then the range of motion is going to be very less. So either we take a higher slope in the tibia, approximately more than maybe 5 degree slope than normal 3 degree in a PS system. So number one, I take an extra slope. Even if it's tight, then we release the PCL slightly to just increase the balance the flexion and extension gap. If still it is not there, then we shift to a PS system. Normally, just by seeing the patient's preoperative range of motion, by this much experience, I've been doing these for the last 18 years now. Though, like now, preoperatively, we see that the patient is better for PS system or a CR system. So we go accordingly.
Is there any difference if I do it with the computer navigation or with manual?
Computer navigation I have, but I rarely use it because by the types of zigs we have with the eyeballing and the type of things, what we can see on table and the balancings that at times computer cannot see. I have been to Germany also where they were using a computer navigation and they notched approximately 2 millimeters of femur. What type of computer navigation is this? I don't know. But computer navigation is a good system. What I use them as a just for check of my distal femoral and the proximal tibial cut. That's it. Just check those two cuts. If they are okay, then we go further.
So do you replace your patella or is there any difference you found out between the...
I am 50-50. Like if it's a very bad patella, I replace it definitely. If the patient, like it's a patient is too much osteoporotic and the size of the bones are very small, the height is less, and the patella at times is very thinned out. So if we do try to replace that, it may get a patellar fracture, and it's rightly said that learn from others' mistakes than do your own. So I have overcome 2-3 patients operated outside with a broken patella and a gone knee. So then I decided, I try to not to replace the patella, but I replace if it is too bad and we will cause post-op anterior pain and too much of crepitation will be there. So I replace in that patient.
What is your physiotherapy protocol, sir, to achieve the flexion?
Physiotherapy, approximately for 10 to 15 days, we do manual physiotherapy by the patient. And within 1 week or so, the patient gets a bending by 90 degrees. And it increases up to 120 degrees within 15 to 20 days when the patient starts climbing stairs and all. The rest, it goes with the muscle relaxation, the bending goes on its own. The patient does it actively, no passive physiotherapy is needed.
Thank you.
Okay. Gauro, do you have any more queries?
No.
Okay. I thank Dr. Mohit Arora for sparing his time with us. And I thank Dr. Salim Patel and Gauro Kanade to be with us on the expert panel. And we thank Zydus, the makers of Nucoxia, for this webinar. We thank you and good night to everyone.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you. Thank you.